don't you walk me through what happened?
Well, on March 5th, one of the girls up there at Mustang Ranch, her close friend, drives her down to Sacramento because she doesn't have a car anymore. It got impounded by the CHP in Truckee, and so she doesn't have a car anymore. So her girlfriend drives her down to Sacramento to Phil's house. Now, she's already told the people at Mustang Ranch, I'm not coming back. I'm leaving. I'm going to Miami, and I'm going down to pick up my Mercedes-Benz. She told her girlfriends that.
I'm going to pick up my Mercedes-Benz. I'm going to pick up
my Mercedes-Benz. And of course, they were like, yeah, right, okay. And so she got a girlfriend to drive her down. On the way down, they stop somewhere around Roseville, and they go to a Target. And her girlfriend, who I finally had spoke to, told me that they were in there, and Jade or Michelle started asking one of the clerks about decon. If you put it in people's food, would it have some effect or could it kill them? And I think the gentleman that she spoke to was kind of like, well, I think if you gave them the poison, it would do something to them. But we were told by our girlfriend, yeah, this is what she was making an inquiry about, you know, decon. And because the idea was she was going to put decon and Phil Inhofer's food, start feeding him poison.
And this was on her way to see Phil.
On her way to see Phil. So they get back on the road and they end up getting it all the way to Phil's house. And so her girlfriend stays for a little bit, unloads the things that belong to Michelle. Michelle tells her, okay, take care. You know, I'll see you. And in the meantime, while they're there, the girlfriend goes in and takes some of Phil's property.
That's right. She takes,
while they're talking, Michelle is talking with them outside. You know, her girlfriend goes into the bedroom and takes some jewelry. And so then the girlfriend leaves and heads back to Nevada. And then that's when Michelle now, it's just Phil and Michelle for the evening, March 5th. But earlier that day, they had gone out shopping and we had found slips and we found out that he had taken her shopping and bought her clothes and bought her a lot of stuff on March 5th. And then after all of that, they came back to the house and prepared just for the evening. And that's when all of this would take place.
So what does the record, because I mean, did Michelle ever tell you what happened? I'm assuming she didn't. She doesn't seem like the type.
She told me what happened. She excluded a few key words like, you know, when I asked, did you stab Phil? She said, no, I hurt him.
So what can you tell us happened that night that you found out from her and from the record?
Well, we found out that they were there together. He and her were preparing to go to bed. Mm-hmm. And he was going to take a shower. And so he goes and gets into the shower. He's in there taking a shower when all of a sudden she comes in. And without any notice, she lunges at him with a knife while he's in the shower behind a curtain. And she starts stabbing him over, over, and over again. It appears that he now pushes a curtain back, which is now in pieces, and bleeding, he gets out of the tub in which the shower was located.
Probably falls, right?
Well, I don't know if he fell, but he doesn't have his glasses on, but he starts probably walking toward her with his hands out, trying to stop this flailing knife.
And she's just stabbing him.
She keeps stabbing him, and there's blood all over the place. They go out of the bathroom, go into the family room. They're probably fighting more. He's trying to basically just defend himself. He's got cuts all over his hands. I mean, there's blood everywhere.
You saw the scene?
Yes.
Okay.
And then he goes down. He goes down. But that wasn't enough.
How many stab wounds did the coroner say he had?
We figure over 30.
Over 30. And the knife was what type of knife?
There were, in fact, two knives.
Oh.
We found, and I observed that on his body, in a position around his neck, there was a knife blade sticking out. So one knife went in and it broke off.
And she had another knife.
And then she got another knife and continued on.
This is 19-year-old.
19 years old.
Okay. So he's now down, right? And but that's not enough.
No, that's not enough. What she did is we believe is she has an aluminum baseball bat. And she just starts taking it to his head to make sure that he's going to be gone. And one of the things that was so strange about that is that a neighbor tells us that somewhere close to midnight, he sees Phil's lights on and he keeps hearing a thumping noise. So he thinks, you know, that Phil is either lifting weights, mm-hmm. and, you know, and he's dropping the weights on the mobile home floor and it's making that thump.
It was that loud.
That loud. And he's in the trailer across the roadway and he can hear this thump, thump, thump. And he thinks, well, Phil is doing something. So he's looking out where the sound's coming from. He sees the light on in Phil's bedroom. And then all of a sudden the light goes out and the thumping noise stops. He doesn't think anything of it other than Phil is probably working out, dropping weights or something. But when I look at the crime scene and when I find out finally what has taken place, I can see where the thumping noise was more than likely her taking that aluminum baseball bat to his skull. And it was making that loud a noise that it could be heard from a neighbor across the roadway.
And, you know, and as we have discussed earlier, she was no little girl.
No.
5'9", athletic. Like, she worked out a lot.
Like, she could definitely give you,
if she could swing a bat,
fight her, she could definitely take care of herself.
Yeah. That loud. Yeah, I did read that in the record. I read that neighbors had heard a loud thumping. I didn't know that it was her aluminum bat on his head. So then what did she do? Did she put him in a closet? Was that what happened? Or,
well, at that particular time, she figures he's down. Mm-hmm. She doesn't stop there, though.
No, but wait, there's more?
There's more. She takes a plastic bag, kind of a, she believes is a coup de grace, and she wraps it around his head and ties it off as though if he wasn't, he would suffocate.
Jesus.
And I found that she had talked about this to one of her other girls up at the ranch. She had talked about, this is what I'm going to do, and asked her, in fact, why don't you come and help me? We'll put up some kind of a thing where we could overtake him or do, and the other girl's looking at her like, get out of here, you know. But she had mentioned, you know, hey, why don't we do this? You talk to him and then I'll come up behind him and put a plastic bag over his head and we'll suffocate him, you know. And then when I read that and then I could see the crime scene, you know, what had happened there, there was no, she had that in mind, that if her stabbing and the baseball bat wasn't enough, then the plastic bag might do the trick and suffocate him. And so that's the way we found him. And she had actually dragged him from the family room all the way back to the bedroom and had placed him in the closet. And that's where he was found by his son.